Madhav Mata, that is our real mother, then Guru Patni, that is the wife of the teacher, Brahmani, that is the wife of Brahmanas, Rajapatni, that is the wife of the king or the queen, then Dhenu, Dhenu is the cow, Dhatri, Dhatri is the nanny or the nurse who takes care of the child, and last is Tatha and Prithvi, Prithvi is Mother Earth. So of these, since we had a drama on Mother Cow, we will talk about Mother Cow first. So the cow is described by the scriptures as our mother. We all refer to Gomata. Why? Does anyone know why? Can anyone guess why? Yeah, she gives us nutritious food and she has 33 crore demigods in her body. So the main reason is, you must have seen a dog gives birth to puppies. Now the dog gives birth to almost 6-7 puppies at one time. They have a litter. And then they have, for feeding the dog, the puppy, they have about 3 or 4 udders. They are not called udders in dog, they are called teats, to drink milk. Same in a cat or in a tiger. They come and they drink milk together. If you see piglets, 5-6 come at same time to drink milk from the mother's body. But a cow gives birth to one calf at a time. But how many udders does a cow have? 4. Why? A cow gives birth only to one calf, but the cow has 4 udders. Why? That is the Lord's arrangement. 2 for the calf and 2 for the human beings to drink milk. Many times people say cruelty to animals, you should not take. But that's how the nature has intended it. After the calf drinks milk, then the human beings can take the rest of the milk. In fact, if the calf drinks more milk, it becomes sick. So after a certain point, the calf is moved aside and then the milkman, he milks the cow. So the cow gives us milk. That is why she is called mother, predominant. That is the main reason. So now, the cow was considered to be an integral part of Vedic society. There was no Vedic society without cow. Because everything that you needed to lead a Vedic life was given by cow. First thing is milk. Milk has a substance which builds or enhances the finer brain tissues which are needed for spiritual understanding. It's called prajna. That type of discrimination or understanding is given only by milk, by cow's milk. It is a very, very special feature of milk. When we start drinking cow's milk, then we'll understand the difference. Second is ghee. Again, ghee is made from cow's milk. Earlier days, there used to be yagyas and pure ghee used to be used. And the pure ghee would be got only from cow's milk. So that is why cow was an integral part of society, because without ghee, yagya could not go on. Without doing yagya, the demigods could not be pleased. If the demigods were not pleased, then there would not be rain. If there was no rain, then there was no food. So that is why the cow was very, very important. In fact, it's many stories in the scriptures are described where Vishwamitra came to Vasishtha Muni's ashram and he saw the Kamadhenu cow and he wanted to steal that cow. And Vasishtha said, look, I don't need anything else. You can take anything else for me, but not the cow. I need the cow because I need ghee for my yagya. I need milk. So the cow was very, very important for Vedic society. Next is the cow gives us dung. Now you may say, she, cow dung, she. You know, in foreign countries, people keep dogs. Actually, that point was supposed to come later, but I'll take it now. They keep dogs and love me, love my dog. They take, even in India, people keep dogs as pets. But why I'm talking about foreign countries is because foreign countries, they have very strict rules about cleanliness, especially on the roads. So if your dog passes stool, then you are fined. So the owners they actually move with plastic bags. So either they have to be quick enough, like you have this video games, click, 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 before it falls, you catch it, you know, on this video. This is a live video game, before it falls, you catch it. Or after it falls, you have to clean it. Either of the two. So they actually do it. Because otherwise they have to pay a hefty fine. To keep the roads clean, they have to actually collect that, it's not called dung, it's called stool. So they do it. So if they can do it for dogs, who are not considered to be very great animals anyway, but the cow is a pure animal and is contributing so much. So we should not at least feel, I mean we may not have the courage enough to go and touch cow dung after this lecture, but at least we should have an understanding that what is the importance of this cow dung. As we proceed, you will understand why I am telling. You must be wondering, why are we talking about cow dung in this Chetana lecture? How is it relevant? But it is. So cow dung is one of the miracles given by a cow. I read one article by a very eminent geologist or scientist, very old article, and he mentions how the British very systematically destroyed Indian culture and Indian economy by taking away cows. When the cows were being used as part of the farming system entirely, the cows are very, very valuable to farmers. Why? First thing is, the cow, through its horns, it actually absorbs cosmic energy. And through its hooves, it transmits that energy into the earth. So when cows and bulls are walking on the surface of earth, that soil becomes very, very powerful. Then the cow dung. The cow eats grass, and then the cow dung which is given by the cow is the perfect manure for the soil. Perfect manure for the soil. Then cow urine, which the cow gives, is again the best pesticide. In our Wada eco village, which they just mentioned, they use only that. They don't use any artificial fertilizers or pesticides. Only cow dung and cow urine is used. And the plants are growing so nicely, the fruits are so tasty, the mangoes growing over there, all organic. What do we mean by organic fruits or organic vegetables? When cow dung is used, then it is organic. When other fertilizers, chemicals are used, then it is not organic. So a farmer who had a cow never had to buy fertilizers from outside. When the British slowly they introduced, in a very subtle way, when the cow was gone, then the farmers had to start buying fertilizers, which was first hit on their legs. Why do farmers commit suicide? They don't need to actually if they have cows. We met one person who has a very wonderful, many acres of land in Karnataka. We had actually gone there. And he was telling us that he was a poor man, was a middle class man. And he was given by the government of Karnataka this barren piece of land. It was barren. Nobody wanted it. Nothing was growing. So he didn't have much money. He took it up. He said, let's try. As a challenge, actually, he took it. And first thing he did is, he bought cows. With whatever money he had, he bought cows. And then, with the cow dung and the urine, slowly, that soil became very, very fertile. Now he has over 200 cows. And he says that I grow a lot of crops. I grow a lot of vegetables and fruits. He says, but I earn more money from the cow dung than from the crops. Why? Because people have to buy it from the market, because nowadays nobody has cows. So they come and they buy cow dung from me. I make more money. He said, cows produce so much cow dung. He said, even if I sell it for 40 paisa per kilo, I earn in lakhs per year. I earn in lakhs. He says, believe me, I make more money from the cow dung than from the crops. Crops, I'm just growing, by the way. And he said that this land has become so fertile, it's growing so nicely. This is all because of Goseva. So actually, farmers can actually profit if they just revert back to the old style. When the bull plows the land, then the land doesn't get hurt, because the bull has that particular way of plowing. But when we use tractors, then we are actually being very aggressive on Mother Earth. So when the farmers used to use these techniques, protecting cow, protecting the bull, and taking care of them, then there would not be cow slaughter. But now, because we don't realize the importance of these things, cows are being slaughtered. It's very sad. In a land like Vrindavan, which is supposed to be the land of cows, thousands and thousands of cows are being slaughtered every day. The butchers come and they actually steal cows and they take them away. And there are many people who are working. In fact, our devotees are also working on this. And there are many people who actually stop trucks and rescue these cows and take them to homes where they are taken care of. Even if they are not milk giving cows, they are given a nice place to stay and they are taken care of, because they know that if cows are served, then the Lord is pleased. So this cow dung has so many uses. If any of you are interested, I'll not go into too much detail, but there is a book called Go Sushma available in the stall down, and it's describing so many uses of cow dung. First is, it is fertilizer for the soil. Second, this cow dung is dried and made into cakes. It is dried. You must have, when you are passing through some village, you must have seen they make cakes and they dry them on trees. So one thing is, it provided employment. It was like a small scale industry by itself. It provided employment for so many uneducated ladies in the village. They could get money by making these cow dung cakes and selling. Now people don't keep cows, so these ladies are unemployed. So these cakes could be used for cooking, or the gobar gas that is generated from cow dung could be used for cooking. It is used in Vada. This gas is being used for cooking, and that is the best food. Srila Prabhupada used to always say that food cooked on wood or food cooked on gobar is the top quality food. Food cooked on gas is inferior, and food cooked on electricity is the worst. It is the worst for the body. So cow dung can give cow dung gobar gas, it can give cow dung cakes. Okay. Even after using this cow dung cakes, after it is burnt, it becomes ash. Even the ash is useful. Even the ash is useful. How? That ash is used for cleaning vessels. That ash can be used for purifying water. One of the brahmacharis in our temple, very senior brahmachari, Madan Gopal Prabhu, he gave an entire class on this. He says, when we go out, instead of drinking bisleri water, which is containing chemicals, if we just carry cow dung ash with us, he said, you can prove it in a lab. If you take water and put little of this ash in that, the water becomes pure. You can drink that water. You can use ash on wounds. My father-in-law is diabetic and many times he has wounds which don't heal. If you put this ash on that, it dries the wound. So even the dried ash of cow dung is also useful. Then cow urine. When we welcome deities, when we install deities in the temple, we use what is called as panchagavya. Five things that come from the cow: milk, curd, ghee, cow dung and cow urine. These are actually used for bathing the deity because it is considered to be so pure. One scientist, he did an experiment in Rajasthan. He actually checked. In Rajasthan, they coat the walls with cow dung. And he actually found out that this cow dung layer does not allow the radioactive rays, the ultraviolet rays of the sun, to enter inside the house. It keeps the walls cool in summer and warm in winter. In fact, my mother-in-law is from the village, so she always tells me that in the village we would put cow dung on the walls, and then we would get milk, we would make butter, and that butter, we would take out the butter and put it on the wall like this, because the walls would be so cool, we didn't need refrigerators. It would stick to the wall, it would remain on the wall for many days and it would not get spoiled. So cow dung can be used on the walls, it can be used on the floor. After the cow dies, the cow's leather can be used for making shoes and various articles. Now you may say, how can we use that? But that is called ahimsa leather. That is called ahimsa leather because you are not causing pain. But now people are killing the cow and using and making leather. Most of the leather bags that you get outside, which is soft, very soft quality leather, it is made from the skin of cows who have been killed for their skin. So when we use ahimsa leather, then we are actually ensuring that the cow lives her entire lifespan. Cow dung again has antiseptic qualities, as we just discussed. So cow dung has so many qualities, milk has so many qualities, buttermilk made from cow's milk has so many qualities. If I start speaking in detail on each of these, the whole lecture we will only talk about this, but I just wanted to arouse your curiosity. You can go on the net, there are many lectures on this, many lot of information available on cow protection and cow products. And you might wonder, what can I do? That we will discuss later on. Next slide. Krishna is also called Govinda and Gopal. Gopal means the protector of the cows, and Govinda is one who gives pleasure to the cows. Go is also the senses, pleasure to the senses. So now Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, and he chose to tend the cows. Isn't that a very bold statement? Doesn't that say something to us? That if the supreme personality of Godhead decides to take care of cows, how important the cows must be. So taking care of cows or cow protection is a very, very important part of our life. Whether we want to advance materially or spiritually, cow protection is essential. So the cows are very, very dear to Krishna. And we read so many accounts that Yashoda Maya, to protect Krishna, she would smear his body with panchagavya. She would take the cow's tail and put it on his body to ward off any evil spirits or anything inauspicious. So Krishna loved the cows. There's one story that once Krishna was sleeping and he was little upset because his friends had been making fun of him the earlier day. All the friends were little older than him, and they used to take the cows for grazing. But Krishna was still taking the calves because he was still young. So they say, abhi tak bachade ko leke jata hai. So he was little upset. So that day when Yashoda Mai came to wake him up, she said, Kanha, get up. So he said, He turned his face like this. So she came this side, Kanha, get up. So she said, Kanha, get up, you have to take the cows for grazing. Pat karke got up. Because he heard cows. So then Yashoda said, but wait. The cows go very up on the Govardhan hill. It's very steep, and the pathway is maybe ridden with stones and sharp thorns. So you can't go. You need to wear chappals. So I've got these soft chappals, slippers made for you. So Krishna asked, have you made slippers for all the cows? She said, how can we make slippers? There's lakhs of cows. How can we make slippers for the cows? He said, if you are not made for the cows, then I will not wear. Don't they get hurt? Then why should I wear? So he said, I will not wear. Now Yashoda could not convince Krishna. But the cows, they heard this. And they decided, we should do something about this. So the cows actually went and they trampled all the thorns and the pebbles, and they crushed them to fine dust so that Krishna should not get hurt. Because Krishna's feet are pink like lotus flowers, like lotus petals. So they did not want Krishna to get hurt, so they went and made this arrangement. So even today, this area called Raman Reti has very soft sand, very soft mud, because the cows went and crushed all the stones, and then Krishna took his cows for grazing. So the cows loved Krishna and Krishna loved the cows. Krishna knew the names of each and every cow, and he would call them by the names. And when he would play his flute, all the cows would come running madly. They would be attracted to Krishna. There's another story which is very, very famous, but I don't know that everyone knows it, about Tirupati Balaji. All of you have heard of Tirupati Balaji? He is very famous. He fulfills all desires. People go for that. But do you know the main story? There's a very long story which I can't go into, but I'll tell you the essence. He came to earth looking for Mahalakshmi because she was angry and she had come to earth. And he was inside an ant hill performing austerities, tapasya, Srinivas or Vishnu. He was inside that ant hill. And what happened is Brahma took the form of a cow, and Brahma would come and pour the milk on that. Lakshmi ji came with a cow and calf. Cow was Brahma, calf was Shiva, and she actually sold that cow and calf to the king of that area, the Chola king. And the cow would not give any milk to the milkman. So he was confused, why this cow is not giving milk? My king has paid good money, he will be angry with me if I don't give milk. So one day he secretly went to see where this cow goes, and he saw that this cow was going and pouring milk directly on this Valmiki. Valmiki means ant hill. So he got so angry, he said, because of this cow I'm going to get punished by the king. So he had an axe with him, so he threw the axe on the cow in anger. And when he threw the axe on the cow, suddenly the ant hill broke open, and the Lord Srinivas Krishna, he came out to protect the cow. He came in between, and the axe hit him here, right here, like this. And the milkman, when he saw this, he got scared, he fell unconscious. When the king came there, he also got scared. Anyway, the story is very long. If anybody is interested, they can always find out and hear. But the Lord actually took it upon himself to protect the cow. And then herbs were put on the Lord's forehead to heal that cut. That is why if you see Tirupati Balaji, this whole thing is always covered with chandan. Why? To remind his devotees that he is actually his Bhakta Vatsala. He loves his devotees so much, especially the cow, that he will do anything to protect the cow. So you can imagine that how angry the Lord must be when cow slaughter is going on. And he expects that all of us, being his devotees, should do something about it. So there's one more story of a cow which His Grace Madan Gopal Prabhu narrated, and he said this is officially gazetted in the British journal. These are times when the British were ruling India. That once there was a group of dacoits, and they looted a bank, and maybe they killed some people also in doing that. And then they were sitting in one place and sharing the loot. So they were very hungry. So the leader, he said that, go and get some food. So they found a cow. So they said, we'll kill this cow and eat her meat. So they brought the cow, and this cow happened to be pregnant. They brought the cow and they told the chief that, we'll go and get whatever other things are required for cooking. You kill this cow and keep the meat ready. We'll come and we'll cook. So when this chief came towards the cow, he saw the cow looking at him with, you know, great longing, imploringly looking, you know, crying actually. It was as if she was saying, please let me go. You know, I have this child, I have this baby calf within my womb. Let me go. So something happened to this dacoit. Although he was very hard-hearted, he was a hardened criminal, but something happened. He felt, I should not kill this cow. So he let the cow go. After some time, the police caught these criminals, and this person was sentenced to death. He was given a death sentence. He was sent to the gallows, and the day came when he was to be hanged. So normally there's a rule that when you hang a person, you can be hanged only thrice. Normally people die. First time only they die. If not first and second, third time, definitely they die. So they are tied, the noose is tied around their neck, and they are hanged like this. And there's a board underneath their feet. So when the board is removed, the person goes down and finished. Story is over. So they pulled. They pulled the lever which removed the board. It moved an inch, but it stopped. It didn't go down. So, first time unsuccessful. Second time again they pulled the lever, nothing happened, the board didn't go down. Third time they pulled the lever, again nothing happened. So this fellow was released from death sentence. Maybe he went into prison or whatever. So he served his sentence in prison, whatever time, and when he came out from the prison, he saw the cow with the calf standing there. This has been gazetted. This is not fiction, it's a real story. So then he realized the cow was holding up the board from down to save his life. So these things are not just, it's not just some fantasy we are speaking about. It actually happened. My mother-in-law tells me a story. She was staying in a village, and when she was pregnant for the first time, when it was time for her delivery, that was when my husband was to be born. It was a very difficult delivery. It was a very complicated delivery. And she suffered a lot. 2 days in the hospital, labor pain, so much problem. And they had a cow in the house, whom she had served for many years. She had gone to her mother's house for delivery, and right from childhood she had been serving that cow. The child was born and the cow gave up her life. It was as if she took on, you know, all the karma or the difficulties, and the child was born safely. So many people who have taken care of cows have actually had this experience that the cow actually reciprocates. It's not just a dumb, mute animal which does not understand anything. The cow actually reciprocates. So again, what is the relevance? What can we do? Can we do anything? No. After I heard this class on cow protection, I actually thought I should do something. First thing is, I should keep a cow in my house in Bombay. Where can we do? I have a house, first floor and terrace. So I told my husband, maybe we can keep it on the terrace. So will we make it go up? Climb the staircase and go up. And then we came to know municipality does not allow taking care of keeping cows in the house, and it's not allowed. So what do we do? How can we help with cow protection? So there's one thing is, first we can become conscious, we can become aware, and we can spread this awareness. We say we are Hindus, but what are we actually doing for protecting our culture? So we have to become conscious and make others conscious. That's the greatest contribution we can do. And second, we can actually use products generated by the cow, because then the demand for cows will increase. When we ask for cow's milk, then the milkman will start keeping cows, more cows. Are there is more demand for cow milk, I should keep more cows. We can use products which are generated from the cow, like we have this angarak. We have, it actually cures skin diseases. We have so many products. If you all are interested, you all can take that book, Go Sushma, from the stall and find out. I won't go into detail, but so many things are there. So that is how we can help in cow protection. So the cow needs us. Does the cow need us? Maybe yes, to protect her life, but actually we need the cow. Next. Yeah, that's correct. We need to serve the cow. We find in our scriptures there's so much importance given to go puja. Actually the cow is worshipped. Why? This devotee, this person called Uttam Maheshwari ji, who was talking to me, I asked him, can I give some donation? So he said, you don't give a donation, you invest in a cow. That doesn't mean you buy a cow. He said, when you actually do anything for the cow, you get million times more benefit. So you can't call it a donation. It's not like you're doing a big favor by serving the cow. It's an investment, because you reap so much benefit. It's like one of the girls said, there are 33 crore demigods residing in the cow's body. So when we serve the cow, they are all being satisfied simultaneously. Lakshmi ji resides in the cow's body. So when we serve the cow, we benefit. So if we really want to know how to be happy, we can start with go seva. So we can spread the message of cow protection, and we can do whatever is in our hands. So this is Go Mata. The next is Guru Patni. The next mother is Guru Patni. Why do we have Goddess Saraswati? Goddess Saraswati is also a mother. She gives us knowledge, whatever vidya, whether it is music, it is dance, it is education, knowledge, whatever comes from Goddess Saraswati. But she gives it to us through the medium of our teachers. That is why our teachers are also considered to be our mothers. Modern culture is, we crack jokes, right, at the expense of teachers. But we should understand that knowledge comes like this, from up to down. So if we consider our teachers to be our equals or maybe inferior to us, we can never really imbibe all the knowledge. So the teacher is like a mother. In earlier days, children would go and stay in Gurukul, where the guru would give shastra gyan, he would give scriptural knowledge, and the guru's wife would actually give the emotional nourishment or sustenance that the children needed. If you have seen Ramayana, when Ram Lakshman go and stay in the Gurukul, the teacher's wife actually gives them affection and love so that they don't miss their mothers. So that is why they were also considered as mother. Next is Brahmani. We won't discuss much. A Brahmana and a Brahmana's wife are also given a lot of respect in Vedic society. Krishna is called Namo Brahmane Devaya Ko Brahmane Hitaya Cha. The Lord actually is a protector of the Brahmanas and the cows. So we have to protect and respect the Brahmanas. And the Brahman Patni was also called as one of the mothers. So next is Rajapatni. So we are done with now. First is Go Mata, then we did Saraswati or the teacher's wife. Teacher's wife. The next we had Brahmani. The fourth one is Rajapatni, the queen. So the queen was considered as a mother, and actually she would play that role. We have all heard about Jhansi Ki Rani. I don't need to tell you our history books. Meri Jhansi Nahi Dungi. They actually laid down their lives to get freedom for the country. There are so many stories. We can't go into detail, but there are so many, because they actually considered the praja, the citizens, to be their children. They would actually go front line, fight. They would come in the front and fight. So they were also considered as mother. As against that, we have queens in Kali Yuga. We heard about one French or in Holland. The minister's wife had some 16,000 pairs of shoes. 6,000 pairs of shoes. It had come in the newspaper. You can't even wear. I mean, you wear 10 pairs of shoes in a day, still you can't complete wearing those many shoes. What they did with so many shoes, God knows. You have Marie Antoinette. In France, when there was a revolution, where the common people rebelled against the aristocracy, because the rich people were getting richer, the poor people were getting poorer, and there was no way the gap could be bridged. Only rebellion would work. So they came storming to the palace, and Marie Antoinette asked her ministers, "What happened? Why are they screaming?" So he said, "Your Majesty, they don't have bread to eat." She said, "Oh, they don't have bread? Then let them eat cake." So out of touch with reality. She took it literally. "Oh, they don't have bread, then let them eat cake. But if they don't have money to buy bread, how will they eat cake?" She was killed. She was guillotined. So when a leader is not in touch, when the leader is in an ivory tower, then they have to pay harshly. They are judged and they are killed in a very harsh manner. So there is no comparison with the modern queens to the queens of the past. They were really mothers. Next is Dhatri or nurse. Anybody, it could be a maid, it could be a relative, it could be our grandparents, anybody who has played any role in taking care of us, in raising us or in nurturing us, is also considered a mother and has to be given due respect, love, affection and reciprocation. So we have to be grateful. Next is Prithvi or Mother Earth. Why is she called Mother Earth? A ball of soil, mud, water, plants. How can we call her mother? The scriptures explain to us that there is a presiding deity on every planet. Just like we have the sun planet and we have Surya Dev. We have moon planet and we have Chandra Dev. We have Vayu, who is presiding deity of air. We have Varunadev, who is presiding deity of water. So we have Bhumi Ma or Mother Earth, who is the presiding deity of earth. We know the story of Sita Devi, that when Sita Devi was found, she was found from the earth. That is why she was named Sita. And when she decided to end her pastimes and leave from this planet, she entered into earth. She actually cried out to Mother Earth that, "I want to come back to you." And a throne came and she sat on the throne and she entered back into earth. There's also the story in Krishna book of Mother Earth taking the form of a cow and approaching Lord Brahma. And she says that there are so many demoniac kings who are committing atrocities and they are troubling me. I can't bear this. Please do something. That's when the Lord came. That's when Lord Krishna came. He said, "I will come." and I will kill all the kings. And he told all the demigods, all of you go and take birth. Take birth in the Yadu dynasty. I will come shortly and relieve the earth of this burden. So Mother Earth is a person. We have a poem, which it was a very long poem. I just took an excerpt. Next one. We love and die in front of your eyes. We again take birth. You give us life. But sometimes in life, we feel your pain. The pain you feel is too arduous to explain. The earth then weeps and just weeps. She never utters a word in pain and grief. Dear earth, you are great, great like God, who forgives the evil who hurt you a lot. Please stop these atrocities with our earth. She's our mother who gives us birth. So she is a person, and we have to be conscious of that. What are we doing to help her? If we cannot be part of the solution, at least we can be a part of the problem. We should not contribute. We should not pollute the earth in any way. We should not add to the global warming by doing things. So whatever is within our means, we should do it to protect Mother Earth, to save the environment, because she is a person and it hurts her when we misuse. But this is a physical aspect, how we can help. Like you may take care of your mother, get medicines for her, give her food, protect her. That is the physical aspect. But there is one more aspect. Just think, in your house, if you are taking care of your mother very nicely, but when your father comes, you don't recognize him. You don't consider him as an authority, or you disrespect him. Then what will the mother feel? Will she be happy? No. The mother will never be happy if the father is not recognized, not respected, not served. And vice versa, she'll be very happy when he is served, when he is respected, and when he is considered as an authority. So if we really want to please Mother Earth, then we have to recognize our Supreme Father. When we serve the Lord, when we recognize him as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then Mother Earth is so happy, she gives in abundance. There is no such thing as scarcity. Why is there scarcity today? Because we are disrespecting Father, so Mother Earth is holding back. Why will I give? You are insulting my master. Why will I give you? You think a mother will leave her property to you if you are disrespecting the father? Forget it, she'll disown you in the will. She said, get lost. Why should I give you anything? So why is there scarcity? Why is there natural disaster, famine, flood, pestilence, war, earthquakes, volcanoes, tsunamis? Why? Because we are disrespecting the father. When the father is not respected, when the father is not served, Mother Earth is going to rebel. She is going to retaliate, and we are seeing it happening. And there's nothing we can do about it physically unless we turn to the Lord. Unless we take shelter of the Lord, there's no other way we can avert these natural disasters. So we did six of the mothers. Cow, then teacher's wife, then Brahmana's wife, then Rajpatni, Dhatri, nurse, and Mother Earth. So now last we come to the main mother, our own mother, Adau Mata. Okay? So now in the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna speaks to Krishna and he says, I will not fight. All of you know Bhagavad Gita, hopefully. Everyone knows? Is there anyone who doesn't know? Then we'll clarify. So Arjuna puts down his weapons and he says, I will not fight. And one of the main reasons he cites is this. He says that there will be so much killing in the war, so many people will be killed, and so many women will become widows. And if these widows are not taken care of, they will be exploited, and then they will have children who are born illegitimately, and then there will be Varna Sankhara. Varna Sankhara means children who are born without samskaras, who are not born properly, who are not taken care of. Then what will be the future generation if such children are born? Because Arjuna realized that it is very, very important to take care of women, because if a woman is protected nicely, if she is of good character, then she can bring forth wonderful progeny who will be future leaders in society. And one glaring example of this is Jija Mata. Jijabai. We see that Jijabai had a burning desire. What was that burning desire? She saw her husband Shahji fighting for the Mughals. She said, why can't you use your power to overthrow the Mughals? Why are you fighting for them? And she actually prayed for such a child. She prayed to Bhavani, and throughout her pregnancy she was meditating on this. This is the power of a woman. All of you have this power. You can actually create a child the way you want if you perform the proper samskaras before the child is born and perform all the samskaras during the childbirth. You can actually, you are a sculptor. You have the power. God has given you that power to actually create. Create according to your aspiration, according to your prayers. So she actually created Shivaji. Her aspiration, her dreams, her prayers manifested in the form of Shivaji, who actually came and fought with the Mughals. Raj Devi Priya was just telling me a story on the way that when Shivaji was small, once he was playing and mother called him, come back. And he said, I'll not come. So to scare him, she said, Bua aega, you know, lene ke liye. Bua aega. So he said, Aane to main ladunga usse. I'll fight. Where is the Bua? So she was very happy. Ah, yes. My son, he is a Kshatriya, like me, you know, he is a Kshatriya. So she made him like that. She brought him up like that, with those ideals and with those aspirations. I once read in one book that one woman was very ugly, very, very ugly. And she was shunned. I mean, generally, people like to make friends with those who are beautiful. Those who are ugly are sort of relegated to the side. So she had met with such treatment and she didn't want that her child should suffer the same way. Actually, she expected that because she was not good looking, her child also would be the same. So she didn't want her child to suffer the same way. So she prayed for a beautiful child who will be not only beautiful in looks but in character, qualities. And throughout her pregnancy, she meditated on all beautiful things. She kept beautiful pictures around her, she kept paintings, she looked at nature, she heard beautiful music, and she kept meditating. My child will. And surprisingly, she delivered a beautiful daughter, a very, very beautiful daughter. That is why when our devotee women are expecting, they don't see TV, they don't see horror movies, they only meditate on the beautiful form of the Lord, they hear scriptures, they eat nice prasadam, so that the child who is born will have all those qualities. So she actually had a child like that. There are so many such instances. So all our mothers have also had prayers and aspirations. And that is why they have brought forth such good progeny, like all of you. Wonderful girls with wonderful character, having such lofty ideals, having inclination towards spiritual life, because the mother has done it. Otherwise it would not be there in the child. It is impossible. Unless the mother has done it, it would not be. So we have a lot to be grateful for, you know, to be grateful to our mothers. There's a story of Dhruva Maharaj. That Dhruva Maharaj, he was a son of Uttanapad. And he once went to sit on his father's lap. And his stepmother pulled him. Story of Dhruva is very famous. Everyone must be knowing it, I think so. So his stepmother pulled him and said, you can't sit on your father's lap because you're not born from my womb. So Dhruva was very disturbed. He looked at his father. Father didn't say anything. So he ran to his mother. So his mother told him, what she is saying is true. She is your father's favorite queen and her son will ascend the throne someday. You have no chance. So he said, I want a throne greater than my father's. So then she guided him. She could have done anything. What would you have done if you were in Suniti's place? Maybe we would have criticized Suruchi. Oh, that woman is wicked. She is envious. Maybe we would have told him to take revenge. If it had been a Hindi movie, she would have said, you know, we have to take revenge against this insult, and he would have become maybe Amitabh Bachchan when he grew up and he would have taken revenge. But what did Suniti do? She didn't do anything of that sort. She said, I have heard in the scriptures that if we want anything, we should approach Krishna. Anything, whether it is a material or spiritual desire, we should approach the Lord, because He can fulfill our desire and simultaneously purify us. So taking his mother's advice, Dhruva went to the forest where he met Narad Muni. He practiced many lot of austerities in the forest. and he actually had the darshan of the Lord. And at the end of his life, Dhruva, when he was about to leave his body, a spiritual airplane came to take him because he was fully self-realized. In fact, he had already seen the Lord in this life itself. He only stayed back for serving the Lord as a representative. He also was given the planet, the Dhruv Nakshatra that we say, was awarded by the Lord to Dhruva. That planet is never destroyed, even when there is annihilation. So such a pure devotee was Dhruva. So when the spiritual airplane came, the Vishnu Dutas came and told him to board the airplane. He said, wait a minute. He said, I can't go alone. I have to think of my mother, because it was she who guided me to this path. Without her, if it were not for her, I would not be here today. So I can't go without my mother. So Dhruva was very grateful to his mother. He did not forget. He did not say, oh, she told me, but I achieved everything by my strength. He was really grateful. So at that time, the Vishnu Dutas just told him, just look ahead. And he saw that there was one more airplane ahead on which Suniti had already sat, and she had already gone ahead. He said, your mother is already gone. Why? Because she guided him and he became a pure devotee. She got as much benefit as him. She went back to Godhead before him. So if we really want to give a wonderful gift to our mothers, tomorrow is Mother's Day. That's why I took up this topic. Everyone knows tomorrow is Mother's Day. If we really want to give a gift to our mother, we can become very sincere in God consciousness. Then our mothers will get as much benefit as us. Whatever we are practicing, they will also get the benefit. So because of Dhruva, because of Suniti, Dhruva went. Because of Dhruva, Suniti went. There are so many other stories, but we are late. Aditi in the scripture is described. Aditi, the mother of Indra, did Payovrat and she got Vamana Dev. Devahuti, she performed austerities and she had a son much later. That was Kapila Dev, not Kapil Dev the cricketer, but Kapil Dev the incarnation of Godhead. So these mothers, by performing austerities and following a strict sadhana, they actually brought forth either pure devotees or the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So they are glorious mothers. So we owe a lot to our mothers, right? We all know it. Is there anybody who doesn't know that we owe a lot to the mothers? No. We all know it, but we don't generally discuss. So since tomorrow is Mother's Day, I thought we should talk about this topic so that we can appreciate, reciprocate and serve her in some way. Mother's contribution is so much that we should actually celebrate every day as Mother's Day. Still it will be less. So there is one story which was very touching, so I want to tell it even though it is late. A mother was blind in one eye and the son was very ashamed of her, very ashamed. He would be very embarrassed to walk with her. He would not like it when she came to his school. And when he grew up, he actually abandoned his mother. I'm telling it in short. And he went somewhere else. He had his own family. And when the mother came to meet him, he said, I don't recognize you, because he was ashamed. He said, my daughter got scared when she looked at you, only one eye, go away. And when his mother died, she left a letter for him. And in that letter, she had written that, maybe son, I should have told you this earlier, but I didn't want to, because I didn't want to cause any grief to you. She said, when you were small, you had an accident in which you lost one eye. And I couldn't bear the thought that you would live your entire life with only one eye. So I underwent a surgery and donated one eye to you. That is why I was blind in one eye. And she said, maybe I couldn't do much for you. Maybe I couldn't make you proud of me. But I loved you, my son. I love you and I will continue to love you whatever you may do. So this is a mother. She sacrifices. She is fiercely protective about her child. And she is willing to sacrifice anything. One of our devotees, he is now 70 years old. He was telling us that in the village, his mother had pyorrhea. It's a disease of the gums. And because of that, her teeth had become infected. And that infection would pass through her milk to the child. So every time she would feed the child would die. So many of her children died because of that. So again when she conceived and the doctor told her this is the reason why your child is dying, she took a very very brave decision, a very very bold decision. She got all her teeth extracted. All. She was, in those days women would get married young. She was like 18 or 20 years old. She got all her, it's a real story, she got all her teeth extracted because she did not want that the child should be deprived of mother's milk. And then she lived all her life with dentures. That time maybe there were no dentures also, I don't know. But what a sacrifice. He said that whatever I am today, it's because of my mother. What a sacrifice. So that is, so all our mothers, they are all unsung heroes. We may know, we may not know, but all mothers have sacrificed their night's sleep, their very blood they have given to raise us. So we must appreciate and we must reciprocate. And we remember, but we forget sometimes. Like Hanuman had forgotten his powers. People had to remind him, you know, you can jump across the ocean. So like that, we have forgotten our mother's contribution in our life. In a special period called adolescence, generally we forget. When we are small, we all know, mommy is the best. We love mama. And maybe at my age, again, we appreciate mommy a lot because we are scared. We don't know how many more years mommy will be with us. But there is that phase called adolescence, where mommy, chi, don't want mommy. The next slide. So at 6 years, mommy, I love you. They want to stick to mommy. At 10 years, mom, okay, whatever. 16 years, my mom is so annoying. Just chill, mommy. Leave me alone. My daughter says this to me. I have 3 children in all these categories. 15, 11 and 7. So all categories. 18 years, I want to leave this house. I can't tolerate this nonsense. Okay. 25 years, mom, you are right. Because by then maybe you have become a mom yourself or about to. 30 years, I want to go to mommy's house. 50 years, I don't want to lose my mom. 70 years, I would give up everything for my mom to be here. So we are in that middle category right now. Not we, I mean you. I am at that stage, I have already gone beyond that. So we have to remember, we have to keep reminding ourselves that what our mother has done for us and we should reciprocate. There is a story, I'll end with this. A man went to a florist shop because it was his mother's birthday and he wanted to send some flowers, wire some flowers to his mother. And he saw a girl crying there. He said, why are you crying? She said, I want to buy a rose for my mother. I don't have money. He said, I'll pay for you. He bought the rose and he said, can I drop you somewhere? She said, yeah. And she went to a cemetery and she went to her mother's grave and she put the flower. The man immediately rushed back to the florist shop. He cancelled the order. He took the flowers himself and drove all the way to meet his mother. So we have to appreciate them when they are still there. We never know. We never know. So we have to appreciate them today, now. Because whatever we may do for our mother, but we can never reciprocate. So M is for the million things she gave me. O is she is growing old. T is for the tears she shed to save me. H is for a heart of purest gold. E is for her eyes with love light shining. R means right, and right she'll always be. So our mother is the best. Mom is the best. So go back home with this message. And remember, you may take any gift for your mother, but no gift to your mother can ever equal her gift to you. What is that? Life. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much.